Good evening. Thank you very much for coming. And I want just to
closer.
I would like to. Can you hear me, everybody? Because I can speak also without the mic. So that everybody feels comfortable. Closer. Okay. So the 100th anniversary, the commemoration of the Armenian Genocide, is quite a long time, a century. And so I thought when Jakob asked me to give this talk specifically on the eve, on the 100th anniversary, I thought that it's quite a major responsibility. And first, I thought maybe I'm going to give a talk about what to do and the current situation with the Armenian heritage right now in Turkey. But then I thought that maybe I can do that another time, because essentially 100 years happens only once. So, and we have spoken on numerous occasions from different perspectives. I thought, what new can we say today on the eve of the genocide with regard to the really big picture of Armenian history? So today, for the first time, I'm going to present to the general public outside of the academia my thoughts that were gradually boiling up for several decades in the process of writing different articles on the on ancient medieval Armenian history, in some cases on the First Republic, on issues like the philosophy of history, on issues like the methodology and integration between hard sciences and social sciences, and how it all comes to better understand the big picture of Armenian history, and where is the place of the genocide in that long-term big picture. So we obviously know very well the dates, and we are not going to talk about the dates. I'm going to talk not about chronology, I'm going to talk about periodization. And before I start that talk, I want also to stress that if you follow close the last 1 year, because already a year ago was the beginning when different academic conferences worldwide were held, first conferences related to the 100th anniversary of the Armenian Genocide, classes, lectures, that continues all the way, continue until today, and they will probably continue also the day after tomorrow. Probably the most, one of the most important aspects that I was so impressed with how this 100th anniversary goes is this enormous increase in the level of intellectuality of approaches toward the Armenian Genocide. That's one thing. And obviously the second big thing, that with that increase of the level of intellectuality, that involvement, research involvement, teaching involvement, intellectual involvement generally, came out way out of the framework of the Armenian community. That's probably the greatest thing that we must recognize as the biggest achievement of the Armenians and in general, and Armenian intellectuals in particular. And so I believe that right now we need to be even more daring, more challenging others, challenging ourselves, going into the future. So what I'm going to talk today will be essentially the summary, the synthesis that I've done of my previous research, and this is the most recent synthesis that I've been working for the last 1 year. So I've given several lectures and presentations to the academic communities, and this is the first time that I am coming to a general audience. I greatly respect the audience of ARPA Institute, because I think that here at ARPA Institute, so many great, deep-thinking people are gathered together. So this was my choice for the first audience to present these results. And the thing that you are going to hear about, yes, they will mostly be facts that most of us know quite well by now, but they will be arranged in a new theoretical perspective. Why do we need that? Because we need to look exactly in this framework to attempt to give a deeper understanding. Deeper understanding not only to Armenian history, not only to genocide, but how to give a deeper understanding to the history of humankind, because if humanity will be more interested in our Armenian approaches, probably it will also do something good both to the Armenian studies and to the Armenians in general. So essentially it was a gradual movement and development, and it's not an accident that in the background I put on a picture of the slide, a picture of a lady whom I've seen during the years many times, that comes to the genocide memorial in Tsitsarnakabert and just sits there for hours and grieves and grieves and grieves. And she's not alone. She is the second generation. The generation of those who fled from the genocide into what was at that time the First Republic of Armenia, and somehow was born there in the 1920s, 1930s, and they are still traumatized by the loss of their relatives, the loss of their families. And when I'm talking, I've talked many times to many of them, the main question was, how could it happen? So it is this emotional deep trauma that continues from generation to generation. But when we are thinking about the way these traumatized people perceive history, the way that they saw that there is no way to exit that dark tunnel. Today, at the 100th anniversary of the Armenian Genocide, I am very happy to witness that our Armenian intellectuals are bringing really light at the end of the tunnel. So let's move a little bit more forward in that direction. It's actually quite a difficult thing to find a picture of the monument of Tsitsarnakabert with having Ararat on the background, because usually it's taken from the different approaches to the monument, and you see this enormous development of Yerevan all around. Nork in the background, Achapnyak on the other side, the central part of the city. So finally I was able to find this picture of the actually late 70s, digitized. Obviously, this is not something taken with a digital camera, where you can see the Ararat, you can see the old Dalma gardens, which are now completely disappeared and exterminated, unfortunately. And I brought here like four elements. We see this eternal Ararat with this very nice sloping, slanting sides, slopes. We see the plain of Ararat, which was for millennia the breadbasket of Armenians and their immediate ancestors. And at the same time, we see Artur Tarkhanian's, Sashur Kalashian's, and Jim Torosian's monument, which is like spiking up, like an enormous spike, disturbing and interrupting this long-term movement of Armenian history. So we have this big, big, long-term, long period. We have this enormous, dramatic event that pierces the Armenian history. And we have a more shorter-term events. This is the release of doves at the genocide memorial. And why I put it? Because these doves essentially symbolize the souls of the deceased, of the victims of the genocide. They also symbolize peace. And interestingly enough, when we are thinking about doves, the figurines of birds representing souls of the deceased that we find we excavate in Armenia, the first figurines go back all the way to 3000 BC. So we have 5000 years of this tradition of relations between the doves, the birds, and Armenian civilization. The events itself is very short term, very short. They are happening periodically. We know from these big changes in the modern Armenian rituals that maybe 50 years ago there will be different kind of rituals. But exactly, I put this picture at Tzitzerna Kaber because of these doves that preserved their symbolism for 5,000 years. And here we have even a more short, like, temporary, like momentary event. It's Kim Kardashian's visit to the memorial. So we have this combination at one single moment of different perspectives, and they all come together. Things that are still valuable and exist today that continue for 5,000 years, dramatic events like the genocide, which compared to 5,000 years was obviously a short-term event, but an event that has shaken all the foundations of the Armenian civilization. And we are coming to a shorter and shorter and shorter term events, but they are all linked. In order to understand what's happening today and where we are going into the future, we need to feel very well and to understand, to be able to interpret which event of the remote past still affects us today and which is not so important to understand. So I'll give you just one bigger example, that a more recent event can be less important than an older event. An older event can more impact our life today, our society today, our nation today, humankind today, than an older event and older process can have more impact than a more recent process. And I'm going to challenge those politicians that say that there is no clash of civilizations today between Islam and Christianity. Because the reality is that there is a clash. There is a clash. And it is a big problem how to solve it. Because if we follow Henri Pirenne's work, famous book of Muhammad and Charlemagne, he essentially ends the history of antiquity not with the end of the Roman Empire, but essentially with the first clash of the Christian civilization of the Mediterranean and Islamic civilization. So it comes to the 7th and 8th century. And it was this big advancement of the first early Islamic imperialists against Europe that when the Umayyad Caliphate came all the way to Spain, to France, and on the other hand to China. The big problem is that politicians, for as long as we know history, when they always tried to manipulate history, instead of trying, and everywhere, we have worst cases, like in Turkey, when from the 1930s through the 1950s, the Kemalist Turkish Republic completely erased Turkish history and it was recreated as a total mythological story that has nothing to do with reality, which is one the most extreme case. Or we can look at a little bit better, but not still very good case, like, let's say, cases of American history, cases of Armenian history, where pretty much historians, in order to make their living, they cherry-pick real existing facts, and they arrange and their historical writing in the way that it either fits the interests of the governments or the powerful sponsors of the ruling class, or it fits the current political views and perceptions of the public. But that kind of history devalues itself. Historians obviously certainly need to understand that they need to be sensitive toward people's feelings. They need to be compassionate and understanding, but it doesn't mean that they need to write the history the way the current moment essentially dictates them. Because if you start cherry-picking facts from here, from there, you can build any kind of history. So, the most important, and so returning to the issue of clash of civilization. When we think about this big Arabic Islamic conquest by the Caliphate, they came all the way to the to France on the one side and to China on the other. And then there was a pushback by the Crusades, where essentially they were out of Spain, out of France, out of all the way out of Jerusalem, all the way out of the modern territory of Turkey. But then we have another pushback that way during the Ottoman period. So we should not forget that as late as in 1684, the Ottomans were standing near Vienna, the capital of Austria, and issuing ultimatums to either surrender or leave Vienna, surrender and adopt Islam. That was the ultimatum sent by the commander of the Turkish army. Surrender and adopt Islam to the Viennese, or leave the city, or we will storm you and we will destroy it. And it was already in the early modern times. It was not so long ago. So then comes the other push back. Islam was pushed back for the second time. With the Western powers, with Russia advancing against the Ottoman Empire. And the result was this big liberation movements, national liberation movements all across the Ottoman Empire, that eventually resulted in the formation of nation states instead of the former Ottoman Empire. So pretty much the Armenian history, the history beginning from the emergence of Islam all the way to the contemporary current time, we can see as this cyclical struggle with the one-time prevalence of the Islamic world, the Islamic civilization, on the other side having the Western civilization. And Armenians, essentially, since the first century, since the late first century BC, since the Roman period, they pretty much, the period of Romanization, it's wrong to say the Roman period for Armenia. Since the period of Romanization, they took the path of Western civilization. So why I'm bringing today this issue, that we see ISIS or ISIL, which is another attempt by extremist Islam now to push back again the European civilization. And why I'm saying that is that today, let's say the events of the 7th century are with us, they are affecting our lives, they are affecting the Armenians, affecting Armenian policies much more than the good situation of Armenians in the Ottoman Empire in the 16th, 17th century. Why? Because what was going on in the Ottoman Empire in the 16th, 17th centuries, it was like the last reverberation of these big cyclical stories, histories of the empires of Eurasia, of which the Ottoman Empire was the last. So practically, and I can give a long talk, I won't do that. This is just one example of big events to show that, let's say, the events of the some of the processes in the 16th, 17th century have less relevance to today's our situation than processes that started in the 7th century. So, just one word from the, in my opinion, number one world historian of the second half of the 20th century, the French Fernand Braudel, who writes, "Each present reality, what is today, assembles together movements of different origins and rhythms, different lengths. The time of today simultaneously dates back to yesterday, to the day before yesterday, and to the remote past." So, to properly understand history, we must study the connections between events and processes on different scales. We must be able to connect how, let's say, the relationship between China and the United States will affect tomorrow Armenia. We must be able to connect how the Kurdish question will affect tomorrow the whole of the Middle East, including the Armenians. So, what you will hear in the next half an hour or 40 minutes will be that I'm going to talk about history, trying not to use any fundamental terms used theoretical terms, I mean, used in Western historical writing, to which also belongs and Armenian, and Russian, and even socialist and Marxist historical writing, because Marxism was also a product of the West. It was not a product of Eastern civilization or Near Eastern civilization or Far Eastern civilization. Marxism and communism also were products of the Western civilization. We should not forget about it. So I'm not going also to use the terminology that is used in our Armenian textbooks and summarizing works on history. And instead, I was looking, and that was my old passion since my years in graduate school, to look at essentially conceptual frameworks that that work together, let's say, in mathematics, in physics, in biology, in society. And this will be the theoretical framework in which we are going to discuss the more or less known facts of Armenian history within the next half an hour. So the most consistent theoretical framework that you can find now, those are still general different kinds of system theories. If we go back to the, let's say, the earliest periods of the emergence of system theories, in the last 10-15 years, we start discovering the works of the famous French mathematician Henri Poincaré of the late 19th, early 20th century that were completely forgotten, but he already wrote a number of very interesting pieces on the systems theory, connecting is from the mathematical standpoint of connecting, trying to describe the theory of chaos and how chaos becomes an orderly, organized universe. And if we go later, that question very much Carl Gustav Jung, the famous psychologist and sociologist, historian of religion, he was very much interested in the issue how in a chaotic situation some kind of systemic order is emerging. So one of his quotes, in all chaos there is a cosmos, there is order, in all disorder a secret order. By secret order he meant not some kind of secrecy or conspiracy, but something that is hidden and that we still have to uncover. So, thinking of these things, we are going also to talk a little bit more about where is the Armenian genocide in the macro periodization of Armenian history. And I'm introducing specifically this term because for 200 years, in Armenian historians have talked about periodization, which means that on one hand we have just chronology, the dates, and on the other hand we try to identify periods to understand the reasons, the causes, why in one time frame things worked in one way and in the other time in another way. So that's pretty much periodization, what it is all about. And the interesting thing is that until now, why I'm so interested in this issue of periodization, to identify features that are peculiar to different time frames. Because without that, that's even talking about the Armenian genocide, we only can put the dates. One thing if the genocide happened in the early modern period, totally different thing if we understand that the genocide was a product of relatively late modernity. So looking at this, here these are all these theoretical areas that try to understand how order emerges out of chaos. And here we have the systems theory, we have mathematics, we have unpredictability, physics, attempts, rules, behavior, ideas. We have long-range theorists, and in this case, this would be me. So to give you the most classical example of an absolutely failed periodization, we can just look at the attempt imposed by force by Stalin in 1938 in his book, The Concise Course of History of the Communist Party. It was an imposition of doctrine on top of historians, including Armenian historians who worked in the former in Armenia and in the former Soviet Union in general. So the whole concept was essentially to take Marx, the views of Marx, to the extreme and to create a teleological concept of history that will show that the path of humankind is a single path. It starts from the primitive society and it has to end with a communism for everybody. And so all the historians across the Soviet Union were required to cherry-pick the data and to arrange their national histories according to that system. And same happened in Maoist China. Historians were ordered to find all these so-called social-economic consecutive formations that have determined always and will determine the future of humanity. So, all the historians were required to identify as the first stage the primitive society, first formation, second, the epoch of slavery, third, epoch of feudalism, fourth, epoch of capitalism, and the fifth, epoch of communism, with two sub-phases, socialism and communism. So, things were like what I call the history of the Empire of Van, which is more known under the name of Urartu, spread it from the Western historical writing again. All the synthesizing works on the history of Urartu and the Empire of Van were required to find slavery in Urartu, of which we literally have absolutely no evidence, neither in written records nor in archaeological sources. Same was with regard to the period, all subsequent periods, because if a formation started, it cannot end being interrupted, it has to continue until the new formation will start developing. And same was with all the rest. So this got discovered. Then there are other kinds of anachronistic periodizations, like subdivisions of Armenian history into two periods, the dynastic period and non-dynastic or post-dynastic period, which is pretty much is an imposition of our modern view that values an independent nation state on the previous times. So what was happening in, and we have several of even textbooks published based on that principle. The dynastic period of Armenian history and non-dynastic. And the dynastic period also disregards and throws out all the earliest periods of Armenian history. It usually starts sometimes in the middle of the first millennium BC. So, because we don't have criteria to define specific periods, for example, if you look through different books on scholarships on Armenian history, in those books you actually will find very contradictory statements. When was the end of antiquity in Armenian history? Critically important thing to understand our current situation, because at the end of antiquity starts the formation in my humble opinion, of an Armenian national identity very similar to the to modern identity. So understanding when antiquity ends is understanding our current situation today. And there is no consensus, absolutely. 476 is the date of the Roman Empire. In the 18th century, Edward Gibbon, in his great work for that time, said antiquity ends in 476. 476 start the Middle Ages. And because Gibbon was so popular, his work became overwhelmingly dominant in the pre-Soviet Russian scholarship. And from the because Russian pre-Soviet scholarship was so prestigious for Armenian historians, they also took and they said, okay, antiquity ends in Armenia in 476 and the medieval period starts because it's the end of the Western Roman Empire. So you see that like ideas that have relevance to, let's say, the western part of Mediterranean even have nothing to do with the eastern part of the Mediterranean. Suddenly we build the divisions of our Armenian history based on some assumptions only because the intellectual, the academic, the dominant academic tradition comes from there. Or there is this idea that the watershed between antiquity and medieval period is 301 CE, the traditional date of adoption of Christianity. Or, according to the late famous historian Yeremian, it's early in the 3rd century. Or, antiquity ends in the 6th century, at the end of Justinian's rule. Or, if we apply this global concept of Piran for the western part of for the Mediterranean world, Europe and western parts of Eurasia, it should be 7th century, because 7th century is the beginning of the clash between Islam and Christianity. So, what to do about all this mess? Same thing goes about the modern period. Does the modern period begin? In the 16th century, with the beginning of the global domination of the Western civilization and of true globalization. In the 17th century, the opinion of majority of scholars, both in the former Soviet Union and today in Western scholarship, including among Armenian historians. Just 3 weeks ago, I had a talk with a very old, of a younger generation than I am, middle-aged, quite respected American-Armenian historian of the so-called early modern period. And I asked her, she gave a brilliant paper, asked her, when do you think modern period starts in general and in Armenian history? She said, I don't know. Maybe in the 17th century, which is pretty much, again, linking those things to the English Revolution. Okay, finally, maybe around the year 1800, because that's only when in Armenia and in Turkey and in the Caucasus the process of westernization starts. So as I said, how we look at and interpret the Armenian genocide in this big perspective depends very much on how we answer these aforementioned questions of periodization. Like the fundamental question that we need to discuss. Are genocides a product of modernity, or they periodically happen from prehistory to the present? For example, if we ask our dear friend and colleague, our great scholar Richard Hovhannisyan, he will be in line with the majority of American scholarship, saying that modern nation states, nation states in general, are product of modernity. There can be a nation state in antiquity or in the medieval period, and genocides are also products of modernity. I beg to differ. I think that pretty much we should not confuse different approaches, like when we talk about identity or about the periodization. And pretty much some of the Egyptologists agree with me very much that ancient Egypt was already a nation state. And on the other hand, I also think that Arsacid Armenia was also a nation state, although I am badly criticized by our colleagues, Armenian historians, for that, specifically in Armenia. So, with regard to the genocide, if the genocide is a modern event, how do we deal with, we treat the destruction of Carthage by the Roman Republic in 146 BCE, which perfectly meets all the six criteria of Raphael Lemkin's and the United Nations Convention of the Genocide. So that's why all these issues of periodization and understanding are so important. So we need to move from chaos to order, to cosmos, to an order in the periodization of Armenian history. And I said that I looked at about 19 systems theories that were developed beginning from Ludwig von Bertalanffy, the great biologist in the 70s, then as the general systems theory, then advanced very much in the 80s by Jay Forrester of MIT, who built the dynamic systems theory, which is pretty much in the basis of today's computer science. And then going all the way to neuroscience, who developed the new systems theory in the last decade. So out of those, I picked the essential conceptual frameworks that I repeat in most of the systems theories. And there are several principles that we are going to apply to Armenian history and to the understanding of the Armenian genocide. First principle is this: all the time, a dialectical connection and conflict between the issue of endogeneity versus exogeneity. To put it in simple words, the systems that are grown from inside or the systems that are shaped or influenced from the outside. Second, systemic self-organization, which is the bottom-up system building from territorial, in historical sense, territorial limited number of elements. When the system becomes more complex, more sophisticated, by itself growing bottom up, versus top down system imposition, when the system is created somewhere in the top of a different society interacting, either societies or within one society, different social levels, and is imposed on top of the society. Then, intrasystemic reorganization versus intersystemic reorganization, which means how a system reorganizes itself within itself, or as the effect of reorganization of bigger systems, to which the system that we are studying is only part of. Then the issue of systemic integration, which is in increasing the strength of system, versus systemic disintegration, or the weakening of the system. And so here, we have this. I looked at all what we have possibly, and what I have studied. And instead of talking antiquity, Middle Ages, modernity, in this West European historical concept, or having state or not having state within the Armenian nationalistic historical writing, applying all these basic principles of these 19 systems theory, principles of 19 systems theories, essentially I was able to identify five major, what I call macro periods or super periods. And we have also a zero period before. The first macro period starts around 3500 BC. It's what I call the beginning of the Armenian-ness. And why it is 3500 BC? Because only from 3500 BC we have sufficient data, sufficient evidence all the way for the last 5,500 years. But now I'm going to talk about each period in the next slides. I will just talk about each of these, briefly about each of these periods. The first period is essentially, and that's, again, I'm saying it's because from 3500 BC we have data, continuous systems and sequences of data.
What data is it? What is the data?
By data, I mean all the archaeology.
What data you have? Your 35,000
Let's keep the question.
No, we are listening on theory.
Please
give examples.
That's why I'm giving right now on the next slide. Thank you.
But let's keep the questions to the end.
So, the first macro period is 3500 to 800 BC. The endogenous, and now I will go through the details, bottom to top rise of complexity. Second macro period from circa 820 to 34 BC. Again, homegrown, but top down, building of empires. Third macro period, 34 BC to 1071 BC, which we will call exogenous, and it's a period, very interesting period of borderland centrality. Fourth macro period that started in 1021 and goes into the future, continues today, goes into the future. It's the period of diasporization, collapse of comprehensive societal systems, and fifth macro period starts in 1828, going into the future. So, we have macro period zero, and I don't include it in the system because we can create many, probably, macro periods when we no more stuff there, and there is very good new data, like the data referring to that allows us to question the concept of human origins in Africa. Most important, most recent discoveries, both in Norgevi and in Damanisi. We are talking about Homo erectus for the date of 2 million years before present. So that's an enormous divergence on a global scale on understanding the history of humankind. So we have things like now we discovered the emergence of metallurgy in Armenia at least 8,000 years before present, or 6,000 years BC. We have the developed stage of winemaking around 6,000 before present, or 4,000 years BC. Here I'm talking this of things that are the most significant for the understanding of world civilization. But we cannot put them in a period with specific features, with specific parameters, with specific frames characterizing that period. That's why I put them all into period zero, which is needs to be studied with the future work, because it requires before the development of major generalizing conclusions requires large-scale further research, because we have gaps. We know nothing, let's say, for the period from 5,500 to 4,500. At the current level precision of our dating that we have for 20, 30 years for things that date back for 6, 7, 8,000 years, knowing nothing about a millennium, it is a huge gap. And we know that there are artifacts, there are features that need to be studied, excavated, and become scholarly and academic data. So we really don't know what was going on in between. So, macro period one, the endogenic rise of social complexity, which means the homegrown rise of social complexity built bottom up, from which includes the whole period from about 3500 BC to 820 BC. So what from the standpoint of purely Armenian history is most important? Because the value of Armenian data is way beyond the value for Armenian history. It has an enormous value for regional history, it has enormous value for global history, for Eurasian, for old world history, but the top thing that we know about this period, from the standpoint of what we think as Armenianness, is that at least since 3500 BC, we have a consistently recurring pattern that the territories, the population of the territories of the Armenian island, create a system called of cultural features that is always constantly different from their neighbors. From their neighbors in Mesopotamia, from their neighbors to the west, from the Euphrates in Anatolia, from the northern Caucasus, and so on. So, let's say when we are talking about the early Bronze Age, we have the specific planning of settlements, we have very specific ideology represented by specifically shaped ritual hearts, we have a very elaborate system of symbolism on the pottery, we have another of technological specific characteristics that nowhere else you will find, let's say, in Mesopotamia or in Anatolia to the west from the Euphrates or in the northern Caucasus. Then when we get to the next period, after, let's say, 2500 BC to 2400 BC, we again have a kind of multiple archaeological features that you cannot find anywhere else. We are thinking of these big stelas on mountains, the so-called Vishap statues, representing all the so-called dragon stones, although they have nothing to do with dragons, but it's the sacrificial stelas that now are being found in more quantities and studied and excavated by joint Armenian-German project in Armenia. Big sculptures up to 3-4 meters tall, and there are nowhere else such as cultures, such statues outside of the Armenian highland. Then we go to, let's say, 1500 BC, and again, exclusively in the Armenian highlands, we find this civilization of top hill fortresses built of enormous blocks, like we call it, cyclopean masonry, that we don't have anywhere in the surrounding regions. We do have it in Greece of the Mycenaean period, of Homeric age, which means, again, second millennium BC. But that's there, but in between, we have nowhere such things. So, together with that, we have a totally unique tradition of metalwork in, let's say, sculpture, miniature and mid-sized bronze sculpture. Again, you cannot find such sculpture anywhere, not in Iran, not in the western parts of Asia Minor, not in Mesopotamia, not in northern Caucasus. So then, when we get again to the period of that same late Bronze Age, we already can make a judgment about unique characteristics of the armament of that period. We have swords with rounded ends that are absolutely not known anywhere in the vicinity. We have very specific traditions in manufacturing daggers and so on and so forth. So by that, what I'm saying is that, and that, by the way, continues. It continues in the period of Empire of Van, and it continues all the way into the late antiquity, and it continues in our medieval Armenian architecture and the culture of writing, and specifically architecture on that same territory. So this is one very, very important perspective of cultural perspective of Armenians, that the population of that territory for 5,500 years produced a specific, to some extent, cohesive and relatively closed system that was replicating its unique cultural forms. Some of them were not continuing from the 3500, or almost none of them have continued from 3500 to, let's say, the medieval period, because some of them were characteristic of the Bronze Age, of the Iron Age, of the Imperial period. But again, they were all unique to that territory, repeating one after another after another. So that's what I want to focus when I'm talking about this period from 3500 BC to 820 BC, characteristic all that period. Well, within that, we have rise of social complexity, like from around 3000, we have clustering of settlements, we have the central town with surrounding villages, then we have empty territories until we have the second next cluster with the central town surrounded by villages. And we have a lot of work done on exploring what kind of social organization was there. Like when we are coming to 1000 BC approximately, we are talking about very interesting state formation. Although now we think that the first states have emerged no later than 1900 BC, and we have at that time also documented presence of speakers of Indo-European languages across the highland no later than 2000 BC, and documented presence of speakers of Armenian language across the highland no later than 900 BC. So that's all the characteristics of the first big macro period. The second macro period is very interesting, and that one which was the most contested when I gave this lecture at the general meeting of the National Academy of Sciences of Armenia like 3 weeks ago, the issue of the second macro period. Because I said, let's try to look at new way how we periodize our history. And the second macro period, like most period got, most people, the historians, academics got upset about it. So what it is about? It's again social complexity. Society is built endogenously, I think, which means inside. It was not imposed from outside powers. It was not result of like replacement of population, newcomers and so on. But it is a totally different system. It's a system of culture building and building of civilization top down, which means that the elites of the empire of Van, they cherry-picked according to their view how an empire should be built. Elements from the Bronze Age Hittite empire, imperial culture, elements from Babylonia, elements from the Assyrians, then they combined them all together. So, and that covers all, absolutely all the areas. The most big contrast with the local tradition of the first macro period is how they dealt with the natural environment. Because during the first macro period, where we have from this 3,500 settlements growing all the way to the like big fortresses and towns of the of about 1200 or 1500 BC, we have the tradition of very deep understanding of the natural environment, specifically in planning. The fortresses of, let's say, the second millennium, they are all planned using the natural relief. What the shape of the mound, of the rock, was giving the most advantageous, these people of the second, the Armenian ancestors of the second millennium, they were essentially using all these natural enforcements or natural capabilities to enforce their defenses. And the Empire of Van totally discards this concept. It's based on building fortresses and cities on the basis of this flatland Mesopotamian concept. So they have to put straight lines and rectangular plans everywhere. They cut through the rocks. They built specific platforms. No curving line could exist in the monumental architecture of the Empire of One. So this is this enormous contrast. And then we have the palaces of the Empire of One decorated with the style of the same styles of paintings and frescoes that we have in Assyria, but the content of those paintings, wall paintings of the frescoes, is totally different because it reflects the pantheon, the gods of the Empire of One, which was also created very imperialistically. Because the top three deities that were governing the top pantheon, Haldi, the god of sky and victory, which was this the so-called native Urartian, I prefer to call it Biainian, the way they call themselves, Van, native god of Van, Vanetzi. The Haldi was their god, ethnic god. Then there was the god Teisheba, which was a Hurrian deity, Teshub, because it was the most powerful god of war. And the third god was Shivini, which is also has a very good in the European etymology. It was the god protector, the god of the sun disk, and protector of the city of Van, the capital of the empire, which has a very good, by the way, cognate in the Armenian, in the Grapar form, Tiv. Tiv means day in Grapar, all the way until the about the 13th century, last time widely used in Mkhitar Ghosh. So, Tiv, and that comes directly from the Indo-European supreme god Tiefs, and that what we see in the god Shivini in the top Urartian pattern. So those were the three most important, and most of the rest, and we have the canonic text of how the pantheon is built around 800 BC, and what sacrifices, what festivals, and what rituals, and what sacrifices should be offered to each of the gods. And there is this long list of gods, and they incorporate the gods of conquered people inside the pantheon. So that was another concept of empire. And probably I can go for hours and for hours to tell about the ingenuity, about the genius of the elites of that of the Empire of Van, of the ruling dynasty, and the people who were with them, how they designed everything from the reorganization of army that made them capable to fight the second largest empire of the second empire, big empire of the Iron Age, Assyria, how they divided their empire into different areas of imperial control, how they managed the state enterprises and enormous estates that were producing wine, producing wheat, how they managed their production of metallurgy, and so on and so forth. So, but what is interesting is that texts all the time report conflict between those, the imperial elites supported by the military and by the top priesthood and the conquered people. And when we go down and excavate, not the culture of these, the fortresses, palaces, and temples, but of the same period belonging settlements of rank and file people, those settlements give us a totally different culture. A traditional popular folk culture coming deep out of the first macro period, which means out of the second millennium BC. So, now the interesting thing is that typologically, so we have this big conflict of cultures between the culture of elite and culture of the people. However, both of them are created locally on the Armenian Highland, endogenously. Their origins are within the framework of the Armenian Highland. And very interestingly, after the this interlude of the Yervandian or Achaemenid Empire, the Artaxerxes Empire pretty much in a totally different historical period, totally different historical situation, recreates and replays this structure. It's also an empire artificially created by the elites, which were relying on what was valuable on the international sphere, in the international sphere, which means the Hellenic culture, the Greek culture, Greek language, Greek architecture, Greek art, and so on and so forth.
Parthian.
And we had the Parthian, for the Artaxerxes, the Artaxerxian Empire was very little impacted by Parthian. It was later, the Arshakunis were much more important. The Artaxerxian Empire was deriving itself directly from, and that we know about that specifically thanks to these wonderful, enormous Greek inscriptions from Nemrouda. Because Nemrouda was the tomb of Antiochus of Commagene, who represented the junior branch of the Yervanduni dynasty that preceded even the Artaxerxian dynasty, if we believe that the Artaxerxians were not Yervandunis. The issue is that who we need to believe. Do we need to believe Moses Horenatsi, who writes that it's a new dynasty, the Artaxerxians, or do we need to believe Artaxerxes himself, who in his recently found inscriptions claims that he is Yermandian? If he will believe Artaxerxes, then it means that Artaxerxian dynasty never existed. The Yervandunis continued until the end of the first century BC. But it's also possible that Artaxerxes was just claiming his relationship to the Yervandians, Yervandunis, because he wanted to legitimize his own power through that kind of relationship. So it's still an open-ended question. But most importantly, that there again, the Artaxerxian empire structure is absolutely the same as the Empire of One or the so-called Urartian Empire, and that's why I put them into one single macro period. Again, we have the elite culture on top, created domestically, not imported from abroad. It's a combination of several foreign elements, different traditions from previous Achaemenid times, ancient Near Eastern, Greek, and so on and so forth. But it's not like somebody brought all these cultures and brought and imposed on the Armenians. It was the elites of the Artaxerxian Empire that liked one thing, didn't like another thing, and that's how they built. They built their religious pantheon the same way. This is, again, we have this conflict, this big conflict between the elite culture and between the popular culture of the people. And so essentially, the essential criticism toward me was that it's impossible to see so many similarities between Urartu and the Artaxerxian Empire. Because Urartu is totally different, somewhere there, and Artaxerxian Empire is like really Armenian. I'm saying, sorry, these are all the similarities that I see. And these are the facts that I'm bringing. And the second, why people got upset, because I am arguing, and I did not first even use that term, because Diakonov, in one single sentence in 1984, called Urartu Empire, and Paul Zimansky later in the 90s wrote a whole book about the Urartian Empire, which I'll call the Empire of One. So our Armenian colleagues get upset because they said Armenians cannot be imperialists, Armenians cannot have created empires, Armenia could never have its own empires. That's why you cannot call the Urartu Empire, you cannot call the Artaxerxes Empire. Okay, and with that we go to macro period three. This also is a concept derived from the applications of systems theory to the interpretation of world systems and world history. Generally speaking, when we have big civilizations, like, again, let's bring as an example the Mediterranean civilization. The Mediterranean civilization that essentially was shaped in the Roman times, let's say the first century, first century CE, it had two kinds of borders, and this is a very good example. One was the border with the so-called barbarian world, in the north, with the Germanic tribes, in Africa, with the Berbers, in Britain, with Scotland, and so on. And they had another type of border. And this is a type of border where one big civilization, the Mediterranean Roman civilization, was bordering on another as great a civilization, which was the civilization of ancient Iran. So this approximately equally weighted, economically, culturally, ideologically, militarily, civilizations with long histories of development, equally weighted from the standpoint of where they've gotten their development, but at the same time based on totally different principles. And that kind of border is a totally different kind of borderland than the borderlands with the so-called barbarian world. Because the borderland between these great civilizations is always a center of attention from both of the civilizations, from both the Mediterranean and the Iranian civilization. And in the recent memory, after the Second World War, the best example of such borderland territory is Germany. Western Germany and Eastern Germany before their unification and the collapse of the Soviet system. So that's the kind of borderland, the important position in which I call borderland centrality. And Armenia occupied that position of borderland centrality for 1100 years. So here we have different mechanisms. It's mostly not already homegrown, not endogenous, but exogenous, big systems. But because those big systems are coming to some kind of economic, political, military, and cultural balance in the long term of the development of history, their border becomes extremely important. And Armenia is in the central place of in between on that border. So that's why we can call that period borderland centrality. And that's when we really can call Armenia the bridge between East and the West. Now, just I'll tell you why the dates are here. 34 BCE, 1071 CE as the criteria for macro period. For macro period 2, it was obvious, so 820 is the formation of the Empire of Van. 34 BC is the date when Artavas II, the last ruler whom we can legitimately call Emperor of Armenia, was essentially arrested, and taken with his family to Alexandria by Mark Antony. And essentially all the Artaxerxes Empire collapsed. The dynasty continued, but it had no roll-up. So we cannot put a borderland on the end of the dynasty like it's done in textbooks, but we actually put the borderland on the end of the empire. So from 34 BC, this borderland condition starts and it goes all the way to 1071, the Battle of Manaskert. Because this position of centrality between East and West ends with the Battle of Manaskert in 1071 BC, the position of Armenia. And by the way, not accidentally, some of the authors essentially take as the very important time point in Armenian history, like still one of the greatest, in my opinion, Armenian historians, René Gousset, with the most comprehensive history of Armenia. He ends Armenian history in 1071 with the Battle of Manaskert. So what happened after the Battle of Manaskert? Instead of this borderland centrality, then the future fate of Armenia continue becomes dominated what was going on in Eurasian empires. So it was conquered, pushed back into the system of Eurasian empires, And essentially, that was the end of the third macro period. So essentially, I'm talking here about subdivisions of the period, dividing into four periods. So you might be interested that the whole period of the Bagratunis, I prefer instead of calling the dynasty, I want to call the period of the Bagratuni Renaissance as an enormous political and cultural event, return to pre-Islamic values and standards and concepts, which is extremely important to understand, especially if we put it into the framework of this periodic conflict East-West, Islam and Christianity. Finally, the fourth period, and here we got to the genocide, is the period that I would like to call this period of diasporization that starts in 1021 CE and continues still into the future. Right? And so you can see that in chronologies there are specific dates when sometimes this happened here, this happened here. Periods don't, one period does not end at one date and a new period begins from there. Periods always overlap. So there is, yes, always. There is the beginning, the change in the trend. People who know financial markets, they know how these changing periods, turning around periods, how they shape it themselves, and then they need time to digest, especially market tops. And then cataclysmatic, you have market bottoms. So this is the such kind of overlap. So we have the end of centrality, borderland centrality, ending later, 1071. But 1021 is the period when Sennacherib Hovhannes, king of Vaspurakan, got so upset and frustrated with a number of these kind of different Islamic raids from Atarpatakan, from Azerbaijan. At that time, we are not talking about what is today Republic of Azerbaijan, we are talking Atarpatakan or Azerbaijan, which is in Iran, yes. So, under this constant threat of these kind of cavalry attacks, robbery and pillage and so on, he takes all his people with the clergy, with his tradespeople, with his farmers, with their families, and exchanges with the Byzantine Empire, who essentially give them a totally autonomous principality around the city of Sivas, Sebastia. And Sebastia becomes the very short-lived capital of that principality of Vaspurakan. So Vaspurakan is moved way to the west. So this is centrally important to see, to understand the periodization within the period of the diasporization from this standpoint of these basic principles of system theories, that we had three kinds of diasporizations. First period, it was the change of homeland. When the whole people, the whole kingdom, in this case, the kingdom of Vaspurakan, gets up, leaves their homeland and moves to the west. We have similar cases in world history, let's say the Hungarians, when they were pushed out by Turkic nomadic confederations from Upper Volga, they moved more than 2,500 miles southwest. They conquered all the central, the plain around the central Danube, and what is called today the Hungarian plain, and they moved together all their ethnicity with their khans, their kings, their priests, their livestock, their everything. They moved, and still they are celebrating today as the day that they celebrated in 19... When was that? When Horthy issued a beautiful medal, I guess 1938, if I'm not mistaken. The 1,000 years of conquest of homeland, because they had to, they were pushed out, they had to abandon the old homeland, they conquered a new homeland. So it is pretty much similar process in the case of Asporakan through negotiation, in the case of the Hungarians of conquest, but it's when the whole socio-political and cultural and economic systems moves from one place to another. Within the same framework, again, within that period, and that's the first period of diasporization. Why? Because they still remembered their previous homeland. Diasporas can exist only to the extent that they are related to either objectively, physically, or at least mythologically to their previous homeland. The moment homeland, the initial homeland where they came from is forgotten, it means there is no more diaspora. So, within the same framework, we can also give like a big assessment to the Armenian kingdom in Cilicia. Because we know very well that in the 10th century, there were Armenians in some cities of Cilicia, but there were no Armenian principalities, there were no Armenian farmers living in Cilicia, and essentially, this absolutely fantastic creation of the Armenian kingdom of Cilicia in the process of the Crusades was another version of creating a new homeland, establishing a new homeland in that system of vacuum. Again, this is the same type of diasporization when you have the full social structure with all social classes, all social levels, the military, the royalty, the nobility, the clergy, the tradesmen, the intellectuals at that time already, the farmers, all together moving and concentrating. So again, Cilicia is another example of the first period of diasporization. Second period. Again, it is the second period, is the period of, again, orderly diasporization of Armenians, but without the possibility to transfer a complete integrated system. So, what does it mean? That in this condition, it's again orderly, it's organized, they go, they find nice place, they negotiate, or if the terms of their resettlement, they acquire responsibilities, acquire rights, and so on. But they don't have their status of polity. Be that a kingdom, be that a great principality, they don't have a political status equal to their neighbors because they have a political organization that dictates them what to do. So they are losing this top of the social system. They are losing this leadership, they are losing the aristocratic elites, and that's where the beginning of loss of Armenian leadership starts. On this big perspective on Armenian history, the second period of diasporization, and the several examples, like I can bring half a dozen or more, but the best are obviously like the very well organized emigration of the citizenry of Ani, first to Crimea, then to Poland. Everybody migrated, they got their territories to settle, they got their churches, they got their schools, they got their rights, they built their communities, but they did not have that political elites that allowed them to have their own polity. So it's an incomplete system, incomplete ethnic social system anymore. So, and the other beautiful example is obviously the transfer of Armenians by Shah Abbas the Great to Esfahan, which happened a little bit under more dramatic circumstances. We know very well that because there was the issue of the movement of the Ottomans and essentially although it's quite clear that Armenians of Julfa already had on their mind to settle somewhere else if they have a better chance, but they were under the threat of the Ottomans. The Persian army of Shah Abbas actually pushed them quite brutally out of old Julfa, old Jura, and but then they immediately got their absolutely elite position, which was negotiated for them in Isfahan. And again, here is that kind of orderly emigration, but without the possibility to create any kind of political framework. And finally, the third period, which we are facing in 1915, besides this enormous loss of lives, besides the tragedy of the genocide not still being recognized to the degree that we all want, and so on, one of the biggest, I would say, biggest hits to the Armenian history, society, civilization, was that the diasporic movement out of genocide was a chaotic movement. That's the big, because everybody wanted who was suffering the genocide just to save themselves. So it was pretty much totally the opposite of previous types of DDR diasporization, where you had the systemic order. And here, this movement came as a totally chaotic event. So again, those few leaders who existed, and we will always remain grateful to them, the churches, the political parties, which, by the way, none of the political parties were created to function in the diasporic conditions. So whichever one, however they wanted to come up with ideas of saving themselves, saving Armenians, saving the Armenian identity, they tried to adjust to this chaotic movement. So, and pretty much the kind of chaotic exodus also happened in the 90s, also from Armenia, which also was very chaotic, as we all remember very well. So it's essentially the absolutely disordered creation of chaotic diasporization created by the Armenian Genocide, and it's one of the major consequences that we need to understand deeply theoretically, and not only theoretically, but also to think how to deal with those consequences, how create order out of the consequences of this chaos. So, getting back to the genocide, and here it's about, again, the length of historical events that affect us. It's what I'm calling, it's my term, the funnel of history. It's the whole socio-systemic dynamics that had led to the genocide. So the first big, heavy rock that pressures this funnel is the spread of Islam, beginning of the Islamic-Christian confrontation in the 7th, 8th century. And just at the beginning, we talked about these cycles of Islamic-Christian confrontation. Then what adds to that? The beginning of ethno-nationalistic movements inside the Ottoman Empire, circa 1800 AD. 1801, the national rebellion of the Serbs. The first time during the sub-national rebellion against the Ottoman Empire, the idea that nations must be created of all these minorities that were conquered by the Ottoman Empire came out in 1801 during the first Serb rebellion. And it was the time when the Armenians were still considered the most loyal millet of the Ottoman Empire. And we have this accelerating process. I can add into this funnel more and more and more pressuring units until we get to the final event, which was October 29, 1914, when battle cruisers Goeben and Breslau transferred from the German Imperial Navy to the Turkish Navy, they bombarded Odessa, the Russian port of Odessa. Practically, on October 29, 1914, the fate of Armenians was already sealed. The genocide became unavoidable because of this also geostrategical situation when we had the Russian army advancing. And whatever the historians say, and the Turks and Enver was thinking, oh, they will beat up the Russians and so on. If you read the works of both Russian military strategists and British and even German military strategists of late 1914, even before the Battle of Sarikamish, the conclusion of the great general sitting in the great chiefs of staff was that the victory of the Russian Imperial Army on the Caucasian front is almost unavoidable. So that was already in 1914. And what we have here, the Armenians have gotten here at the very end of this compression in that funnel. So maybe it would have taken a little bit different forms, but also I can, I am a little bit disturbed by the fact when Armenians so easily accepted the term that the Armenian Genocide was the first genocide of the 20th century, because when you read the documents about what was going on in 1904, 1906 in southwestern Africa, essentially the German military exactly rehearsed there the model of the Armenian Genocide with the Herero population, because at that time already there was this German nationalistic ideal of Lebensraum, which means the concept of necessity of conquering the living space and eliminating everybody else in that living space. And German Southwest Africa was conquered based on that premise. And the local Herero population was given an ultimatum to completely leave the whole country. When they didn't leave, what was done first of all? They said, okay, let's come here, men. We are going to collect you. We are going to put you to work. They brought them to one single enormous place. And the Germans put the heavy artillery and they shelled them, they killed them, all of them. And then they went out. They captured, they seized settlement by settlement, village by village, the elderly, the women and children, and drove them to march into the desert with in convoys without allowing them to get and have water from the sources of water. And that preceded by 10 years the Armenian Genocide, and the German officers who were in Southwest Africa that were at the helm of the German command during the First World War. So we need very seriously to think where the origins of the Armenian Genocide comes from the standpoint of tactical, how it was executed, and to rethink the responsibility of the German Empire. So now I want to finish already. Here was this, at that time, inescapable situation for Armenians. If the situation, we can now construct different alternative models. Probably if Armenians had the same position in the Russian Empire as they had all the way through the rule of Alexander II, emperor, when Loris Melikov was the prime minister and dictator of Russia, or if it happened under Nicholas I, when the Lazarian brothers had an enormous influence on the emperor, if we had such Armenians in 1914, probably the scale of the genocide, the government of the Young Turks probably wouldn't have succeeded in committing so many atrocities, simply because in the fall of, already after the resistance of Van, and towards September, October of 1915, the Russian army had the capacity to advance essentially and defeat the Turks and take over and go all the way through Erzurum and to Mush and Harbert, all the way to Malatya, which they did only a year later, in 1916, when the genocide was finished and completed. Also, since we even read the writings of 1913-1914 of Armenian intellectuals in Istanbul specifically, they were warning about at least a dozen of people were warning that this such kind of great calamity, new Met chart, much worse chart than that one of the Abdul Gamid's chart of 1895, was coming. And obviously, having such porous borders like between the Iranian Empire and the Ottoman Empire, at least several tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of people could have been taken out through that border. Probably in the earlier period, there could have been even done exchange of population and so on, but nothing of that was done by the time, by October 29, 1914, and that exactly resulted in the Armenian Genocide. This is what, when I say that the 7th century has its extreme importance today for us, that's what I mean. So here is that the Armenian Genocide, besides its tragedy, besides the necessity of its recognition, also has left a very challenging historical legacy. First, we don't speak enough about the post-traumatic stress disorder among the Armenians, because usually when we talk about PTSD, we always mean either individuals or social groups. Sorry. In the case of the Armenian Genocide, there were generations, three generations, four generations, including my generation, our generation, that still suffered from that post-traumatic stress disorder. So it has created a very pessimistic worldview. We should not forget that. And it cannot be cured without the recognition of the genocide by the Turkish society. And again, I am not saying that Armenians can recover all their losses. It's simply impossible. But lost is lost. The problem is that history is linear. You cannot turn back. You cannot return history. But to some extent, some kind of cure of that post-traumatic stress disorder probably can be reached if there is a recognition of the genocide by the Turkish society, which is much more important than recognitions by the governments globally. And I'm not degrading the importance of struggle to have a global recognition. The fact that now we have a relatively subdued, I was expecting a much more aggressive counterattack by the Turkish government to the celebration of the 100th anniversary, it's pretty much subdued. And it's because not only a number of leading, even Turkish academics, came to the recognition of the Armenian Genocide, but also governments. But Armenians will have to deal with Turks on a daily basis. It's historical necessity, it is unavoidable. And unless the Turkish society, generally speaking, does not recognize the Armenian Genocide, the wound will still not heal. So this is very important thing. Second, but as I said, we need to deal with it. It's the creation of the chaotic condition in the Armenian diaspora, which consequently created the challenge of self-organizing of a new systemic order out of chaos, because we still don't have a good vision of how the Armenian diaspora has to self-organize. There are different opinions, but we actually don't have soundly based theoretical academic concepts that can be implemented. For example, with respect to political parties, I've heard very often opinions expressed that because now there is the Republic of Armenia, there is no need, and especially from many people from the government in the Republic of Armenia, there is no need for existence of political parties in the diaspora. I totally disagree with that view. The issue is that we need to accept the fact that the diaspora will need a form of its own political organization. Also, it's obvious that all our historically very important political parties, they were not formed to work in the diaspora. They were not created for the conditions of a diaspora. So there is an absolute necessity to do very serious work to find the ways of the political reorganization of the diaspora. And essentially, the other consequence of the genocide is this creation of three very disparate groups of the Armenians worldwide. It's not the diversity in the diaspora. It's not Armenian of Armenia versus the diaspora. But the reality is that the present mix of the population of Armenia is also the result of the genocide. The present state, as I said, of the Armenian diaspora is a result of the genocide. And right now we have a third big component, is the Turkified Armenians in Turkey who attempt to regain their ethnic identity. So these are all consequences that we have to deal with regardless of the acceptance of genocide. But we have to deal with these consequences. And finally, the biggest challenge that comes with the macro period 5, which, like the period of diasporization, continues into the present. These two periods, macro periods, overlap. And the macro period, the challenge of macro period 5, which starts in 1828, in my opinion, is the recreation of nation state under conditions of globalization. So if we can address this big issue, most of the other issues will get resolved by themselves. If we have a strong diaspora and a strong nation state, the issue of Armenian identity, of preservation of Armenian identity, will be resolved by itself. So it all combined, very much combined events. And the biggest problem that is requires your resolution is that we recreate. How successful it will be, it's a question of the future. But we are recreating a nation state much later than the Western civilization, than Europeans, have created their nation states. So we are lagging very much in time. We are doing things that others have done in the 17th, 18th, 19th century. Today, when the whole world and Armenians and the diaspora are under this enormous pressure of globalization. So this big fundamental challenge of the contradiction of very late recreation, and I am not specifically using the term re-establishing nation state or remaking it, we are recreating later because we lost our nation state. So we are recreating under new conditions. And we are recreating it much later than the nation states of the West and the United States and even South America, much later than they were created. So we are, as I said, we are doing the work of the past under the pressure from the future. And this is a big theoretical academic problem, how ethnicities should survive and thrive in under conditions of globalization, and if our academics from all the fields of the social sciences and the humanities to more or less involved with Armenian issues find answers to this question, this will be an enormous contribution to the future of Armenians and the Armenian nation and the Armenian people, and it will be an enormous contribution to world social science and to humankind, because it will be a very important model of successful management of global problems. Thank you very much.